The stage is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you. While we're resetting the stage, let me introduce this session. I'll introduce myself. My name is Jon Fasman. I cover Southeast Asia for The Economist. And the session that I'm moderating right now is called View from the Top. And to me, one of the most gratifying aspects of the success that the gay rights movement has had around the world in the past decade or two is the extent to which it has really been grassroots driven. You have LGBT men and women who have taken the brave step of living more openly, showing their neighbors that their prejudices are unfounded, that there's nothing to fear, that they're like everyone else. You have consumers who started paying attention to which companies had diversity policies and directing their money accordingly. But there is still a role for top-down leadership, and that's what this session is going to discuss. What role does a company's chief executive play in creating an inclusion and diversity agenda and really making sure it's followed every day? How does the head of a company assure that the agenda's stated values thrive within the company? And can a boss influence a company's board and vice versa? What obstacles does a progressive boss have to overcome? So to discuss these questions, I'd like to invite my panel up. We have an extraordinary panel with you today. Please. Come from here. We have Ma'an Hontiveros, who is the chair of Philippines AirAsia. We have Mr. Michael Ebeid, who is the director and chief executive of the Special Broadcasting Service, an Australian network. We have Mr. David Korunic, who is the chief executive of Krungthai-AXA Life Insurance. And finally, we have Yoichiro Hirano, who is the chief executive and co-founder of Infoteria, a Japanese software firm. So. Okay. Ma'an Hontiveros, let's start with you. And let's start with context.
Okay.
Tell us broadly about the state of LGBT rights in the Philippines, both legally and in terms of social attitudes.
Well, in terms of social attitudes, the Philippines has always really been liberal. As far as LGBT communities are concerned. However, a lot of that was also sort of a narrow field. Mm. Like Filipinos accepted gay people, but expected them to be hairdressers and fashion designers and artists. That has changed considerably now. We have the first woman transgender woman as a member of Congress, Congresswoman Roman, and I think generally, if you poll the public, they would go for same-sex marriage, but legally, same-sex marriage is not yet recognized, and a person who has changed his sex will still have to carry the assigned sex at birth as a definition of his gender. So we have a long way to go.
I wonder if I can ask you, what was it that sort of changed the minds of Filipinos? You said that the gay men and women were accepted within a sort of narrow range, but that's starting to change. Was it people being more open? Was it particularly salient individual examples? What was it that broadened minds?
I think a combination of all, and also because of technology, access to information from all over the world, and other examples of how LGBT people really can go enter any field. That has, the millennials, for instance, are very, very much more accepting of it. My brother, who is a baby boomer like me, is, on the other hand, still a little bit surprised about how things are. And I remember taking him once to Castro for the gay for the Pride Day, and he was just apoplectic. So in fact, he was telling a police woman, isn't there some law against this? Aren't you going to arrest them? And she says, no honey, not today, no arrests today.
And what sort of diversity and inclusion policies does Philippines AirAsia have?
Last year, well, as a matter of fact, it had never really been an issue. But I guess with Congresswoman Roman winning the election, it went into the forefront of discussion. So I remember we were having a board meeting in August last year, and there was a news person outside who then waylaid Tony Fernandez as he was coming from the men's room and said, so is AirAsia going to accept transgender flight stewardesses? And so he said, sure, why not? But let me ask the board. So he came in and asked us, he says, what's our policy on transgenders and LGBT? I said, well, you know, we've always, there's never been any exclusion, but maybe we should proactively announce that we will accept, and in fact, we invite transgenders and LGBT community to apply across all the departments of AirAsia. So we carried it as a unanimous motion in the board to actively seek out applicants from the LGBT community. And I'm happy to say that this year we finally had two applicants for cabin crew, transgenders, and one of them made the initial pass from the interviews and is about to go on training in our school in Malaysia. And she happens to be also quite a celebrity because she won Miss Universe Queen in 2014 in Pattaya. And everybody seemed, that I've talked to in the company is very happy about this. And although we can't claim to be the first airline to hire transgenders as a cabin crew, there was one in Thailand, but that company has now become defunct. We're still happy to show really that AirAsia is very inclusive. If you can notice our cabin crew, they have their hairstyles any which way they want because we really want our employees to feel empowered and to express their authentic selves. So yes, we're very, very happy about
So I
this.
Wonder if I can pick up on something you mentioned. You said we have always been inclusive, there's never been any exclusion, but maybe we should be proactive.
Yes.
Can you talk a bit about the difference between those two positions? One is, you know, we're fine, no exclusion, and the other is proactivity. What messages does each one send?
I think the message that we send out is that we want to attract the best talent, okay? And when you're just silent about it, people are not quite sure. Are we going to be welcomed, really? Or is there going to be like a bias against us if you don't state it outright? And also, nothing is perfect yet. For instance, when we send send out an ad recruiting cabin crew, we always say standards for height and weight, female, five, whatever, male, this. And so there's only those two categories, male and female. So even our internal as well as external communications have to be worked on. And these are all under review now by our current CEO and our people department to try and make sure that even in the interview process, people aren't, you know, aren't asked what their sexual orientation is, what their marital status is, and that sort of thing. So it's very important. You have to state it. You cannot just say, well, you know, everyone's welcome. But what does that mean? Everyone's welcome.
Did you have any pushback from the board when you went to them for this? And more broadly, what should the sort of, what should the role be of a CEO in influencing the board?
Actually, there was no pushback from the board. It was like a non-issue. And at that point, I was no longer CEO. I was chairing the board. And when it was brought to them, they said, of course, of course. You mean we don't have one yet? Well, it was one of the questions asked by one of the board members. But then again, you know, our board members, they're all very young, progressive people. So that might be also part of the reason why it sailed through very, very easily. And you know Tony Fernandez.
That helps.
Yeah,
having a progressive voice at the top always
helps. Voice, and you know that the founders of the company were mavericks to start with. You know, so it was easy sailing.
And can you talk about the sort of hospitality and travel industry more broadly? What its role is in influencing other sectors?
Well, I think we have a lot of contact with people. I mean, the very nature of our business, and it's a very, very visible type of industry. So I think we wield a lot of influence even with our customers. So I think as agents of change, a company like an airline is a very powerful agent of change. You know, it's really out there in front of you. And I'm personally very excited to have Kevin finally join us and see her in our AirAsia uniform.
When does she start?
She'll be training this month.
She'll be training this month, so her first flight is?
It takes about 3 months before she's deployed on her first flight.
Oh, that's
flight.
Wonderful. Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's worth a round of applause, I think. Now, Malaysia, well, let's not go there. To what extent do you think a company's culture, say, if a company happens to operate in a more sort of conservative society, to what extent can a company, should a company press for gay rights more broadly? To what extent should it influence society more broadly?
Well, you didn't want to mention Malaysia, but I did mention that our training center, our school, is in Malaysia. Mm-hmm. And so, for instance, with this very specific example, Kevin carries in her passport, her status as a male, mm-hmm. because she was born a male, and we still don't have the laws in the Philippines that will recognize the sex reassignment. Mm-hmm. So we had to actually proactively speak to Malaysian immigration, mm-hmm. To advise them that we have Filipino cabin crew coming in for training, and should there be no issue, and apparently no issue.
No issue at all.
No issue at all.
Oh, that's great. Now, when we emailed earlier, you mentioned that family and cultural obstacles within a company,
yes.
For family and cultural attitudes, might prove obstacles to a broader sort of D&I policy. How do you overcome that within a company if you have more conservative employees?
Well, first of all, there's got to be a lot of information.
Yes.
Even with the entry of Kevin, we need to be able to cascade to all of our employees down the line that, you know, we have our first transgender. It's also the way you present it to them. For us, it's a very, very positive thing.
Yes.
And there are issues, for instance, about which toilet facility is she going to use? Mm-hmm. Is it the male room or the female room? And as far as we're concerned, we think there's going to be no issue. But if anybody's uncomfortable about it, you know, go to people department and you might want to use the facility that's right now labeled handicapped, mm-hmm. right? It's a single user facility, which I'd also like our CEO to consider to change into just call it an single user facility or something, so that anybody who's uncomfortable with it can use it.
Right.
But at the same time, we don't really see why they should be uncomfortable with it.
Right. And how do you ensure that that policy is followed throughout the company? Is it hiring? Is it mentoring? Is it information? Is it some combination of all of those?
All of the above.
Yes.
And as a matter of fact, I think even especially the managers, because it needs to be cascaded down the hierarchy. Oh, I forgot to mention to you. So after the meeting, the board meeting, went outside, and Tony Fernandez tells our CEO, who's a pilot, mm-hmm. From a former Air Force pilot, hey, Dexter, guess what? He says, you know, the board just said we got to go out and hire a transgender stewardess. And he said he didn't know, he couldn't quite decipher the look in Captain Dexter's face. It was like, are you joking? So he said, well, I think Captain Dexter was a little bit shocked. I said, I'll go talk to him. I said, you have any problem with it? And he says, no, I don't. But he says, you mean you really had a board decision about it? I said, yes, we did. I said, do you have any problem with it? Oh, no. He said, but it took him time to recover from
yes.
that. So all of the heads of department also were informed.
Yes.
And we said, you know, you need to talk to the people that report to you and have them understand that, you know, Kevin's got to be welcomed. Mm-hmm. And anybody that has difficulty with this, please go to people department and maybe they can be mentored and counseled and enlightened or mm-hmm. whatever. Mm-hmm. So that's the way we do it. And it's a very open company in
openness
the first
is
place.
Important.
Very, very,
yeah.
very.
So everyone throughout can
yes.
share. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Before I move on to Mr. Ebeid, I wonder if can you please put up the polling question, and we'll vote on this throughout this session. And the question is, let's see, is it up here yet? Yes. Here's the question. You can vote on it on the app. Do company bosses do enough to champion LGBT rights in public? And that is a yes or no question. You just click submit at the bottom in the app after you've chosen your answer. And we will come back and discuss how people voted in this room and how people voted more broadly on Twitter a little later on in the session. But first, I'd like to talk to Mr. Ebeid. Set the stage for us, same question, sort of broadly. The state of LGBT rights in Australia, social attitudes and laws, and SBS and its policies.
I'll take it in that order. So generally, LGBT people in Australia are very well protected under our laws. We've got great discrimination laws. Homosexuality was decriminalised in the late 80s, which is great. And I think society generally is very progressive. Corporations have got strong laws around not discriminating against people with, you know, different races, sexual identities and genders, etc. But the problem that we've got at the moment is that the government actually is discriminating against LGBT people in terms of same-sex marriage. Mm-hmm. So the issue that we're debating in our country at the moment is around marriage equality. And we've really, in so many ways, got ourselves in a political knot over this, because all of the polls that we've done nationally say that Australians, by and large, and they're usually a couple of percentage points difference, around 70% of Australians accept marriage equality and think that we should just get on and do it. Mm. But it's really held up in the political system at the moment. And we have an incredibly unusual situation where we have the Prime Minister of the country who's very supportive, the opposition leader is very supportive, and by and large about 65-70% of the Parliament is also very supportive, yet we can't seem to pass it. So I suspect it's something that the government will need to address in the near term. We certainly hope they do. So by and large, I think, you know, we have a very accepting culture in Australia. It's changed a lot, you know, over the years. Certainly when I first came out in, early 90s, you know, it had just been decriminalised. I obviously knew a little earlier when it was a criminal offence. And so people grow up hating themselves because of that. And, you know, attitudes have changed enormously over the years, and it's through education. Mm-hmm. Through education of people understanding. And having gone from a mindset of probably the 60s and 70s where, you know, homosexuality was disgusting, it was immoral, it was perverted, and we're all deviants. I wish I was a deviant, I was really quite boring. But, you know that's the problem. And now we've moved away through education and people understanding that actually we're all very normal. We want the same things in life. And we can contribute enormously in the business sense. And so we've come a long way in Australia.
At what point, if I can ask, at what point in your career were you when you came out? And were you nervous? Were you scared? What drove you to do it?
Terrified. Yeah. And I was working for IBM at the time in the late 80s. And IBM at that stage was an incredibly conservative organisation. I mean, it had in its policies that men must wear blue suits, red ties, white shirts. It was in the policies that women could not wear trousers, right? Wow. You had to wear stockings. That's how conservative it was. And, you know, I remember every Monday morning you would go to work and you would lie about who you were with on the weekends because you didn't want anyone to know. And as I got a bit older in my sort of mid to late 20s, a boss called me in and said, look, I've heard rumours. Are you gay? And I was like, well, how do I answer this? And I just said, look, you know, I'm not comfortable talking about this. And then he gave me a big lecture about if you come out gay, this will be the end of your career. Your career will not go anywhere. Now, I tell that story not because I think IBM's bad, because IBM now is one of the most progressive organisations in LGBT policies, and they've come such an enormous way from the, you know, late 80s, early 90s. And in fact, when IBM Australia launched their first Pride group, I was asked to come back and actually address the group, which I was really proud to do. And so the journey that just one company alone like that has gone on and then effectively become a leader to other corporations just goes to show you how much we've come along. Yeah.
Now that change, was it bottom up, was it top down, or was it a mixture of both?
the change in
let's take IBM as an example first. I mean, it started out very conservative. It's now it's now very much a leader.
Yeah. Well, obviously, I can't talk for IBM because I left IBM, you know, 20 odd years ago. But
well, let's talk more broadly. About
I think more broadly, I think the biggest change that I'm seeing is more and more CEOs and senior executives are realizing that there really is this business case perspective, and increasingly, you know, I think it was Forbes magazine last year or year before did a report that said most of the organizations who are leading in LGBT inclusion programs, CEOs do it for one of two reasons. They either believe in the business case perspective that it is about having employees being far more comfortable at work, giving their best at work, being really productive and having their best ideas from an innovation and creative perspective, or the CEO's doing it because of a moral imperative. They think it's just the right thing to do. Now, either way, I don't really care which way you do it because they're both good reasons. But increasingly, people are talking, executives are talking about, well, it's just the right thing to do. For me, one of the other things that I think is incredibly important in this journey for a lot of organisations is that you don't approach inclusion policies simply by having an ideological perspective that, you know, it's trendy, everybody else is doing it, we have to do it. For me, I think it's about saying to your organisation, well, what are our company values? What do we want as our organisational values? Because if you believe in values of fairness, respect and equality for employees, then it makes it really simple when you're having a conversation about implementing policies, inclusion programs, or indeed when you're having to have a conversation with your board or a customer who's really upset about what you're doing in the GLBT space, because they will actually, our organisation's values are this and we want to treat people this way and so therefore this is important for us. And having those corporate values really helps, I think, roll that out, even to employees, whether it be that pilot example. It, you know, there'll always be some employees who are very uncomfortable about, you know, why do we need, you know, GLBT inclusion and why are the GLBT community a special minority? And a big part of that is about education. You know, helping people understand, well, actually for the GLBT community, the reason this is important is because you're a minority of one often in your own family. So, you know, if you're an Asian in, say, Australia in a multicultural, you know, setting, if you're an Indian, a black person, wherever you're from, when you go home at night and you've had a terrible day, you've been discriminated against and you've had, you know, people doing all sorts of things to you, when you go home, you're still part of your family. You're part of the family. But when you go home as a gay person, you're often the minority of one, and often the biggest stresses in your life is from your own family, sadly. And that still exists for a lot of people in their families. And so to have a really safe and inclusive environment at work is incredibly important, incredibly important.
And what are SPS's policies? We didn't,
Yeah, so our policies are very much driven off our culture work. So about 6 years ago, I started a cultural change program in the organisation. And for those who don't know SBS, I should probably just mention that at the beginning. SBS is a broadcaster in Australia. We have about five television free-to-air stations, six radio networks, and a big sort of online presence. And we focus, we focused our purpose 6 years ago when we were building our culture around what sort of network do we want to be? And we said that our purpose for existence was around getting all Australians to explore and appreciate and celebrate our diverse world, our diverse culture, our diverse society. So a lot of our programming is around multiculturalism. It's about very different cultures, race, religions, including GLBT programming, which was a change because, you know, to have gay-themed movies on free-to-air television was kind of a big thing. Not everybody was happy about it. But if we're going to believe in diversity, we had to reflect that diversity on screen and internally. And so if we were going to do it in terms of our content, whether we're reporting on it in our news division, whether we're doing documentaries, Whatever the race, minority, culture that we're reporting on, we needed to reflect that internally as well and make sure that we've got really good programs and initiatives internally to not only attract diverse workforce, but also to make people feel really comfortable to speak up, etc. So a lot of it is around behaviours. It's around what sort of behaviours do we accept as an organisation internally and what do we not, and be really clear about that as well. So we did a lot of programs, online training tools, etc., around behaviours and values within the workplace. But really importantly, we also empowered employees. We empowered employees to be able to speak up. Mm-hmm. So if you see somebody making a derogatory joke about a race or a culture or a gay person or any of those sort of issues, that it's okay to challenge people, no matter if it's your superiors or not. Mm. And we did it in a kind of a fun way as well. We didn't take ourselves too seriously with all this, and I think that's an important part of the journey that we found. So it was really about setting the standards and making sure that our senior executives and leadership team from the board down really lived and breathed that. That was really critical. And then helping people in that education journey about why this is important. So I think, you know, you'll get nowhere if you just stand from the top of the organisation and say, right, we have to have inclusion policies and we've got to do this and we've got to do that. I don't think that works. I think you've really got to be able to bring people on that journey of explaining why minority groups need to be supported, why, you know, to get the best out of people at work. Yes. Mm-hmm. It's important.
Yes.
And people then started going, okay, I get it. Because if you're not exposed to any of those things, you don't know what a cultural sensitivity might be.
Yes.
If you've got a Muslim colleague for the first time ever, if you've got a gay colleague for the first time ever, you've got to understand how to deal with that. So we believed in it so much that we actually developed an online tool that we're now selling to other organisations for cultural competency.
Oh, that's great.
And it's been really interesting to get organisations to say, well, actually, part of your inclusion programs, why don't you include this to help people learn on their own time, in their own space, around what's important and why.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to turn to David now and ask this the same opening question. State of play in Thailand, legal rights and cultural attitudes.
Yeah. Thailand is a very interesting place. We say it's the country of 1,000 smiles. Mm-hmm. A large portion of the population is within the LGBT community in Thailand as well. However, there is a little bit of a dichotomy because, like the Philippines, it's not as accepted by the law, etc. Also within the family units, there's a lot of pressure on people to follow social norms in that. So you do find a lot of people who are gay becoming married, having children, etc. And it's only later on in life that maybe then they start to actually open up and come out. Mm-hmm. Also, same-sex marriage is not allowed in Thailand.
So people can live openly. Often.
They live very openly.
And without legal protection.
Without legal protection, yes.
And what about Krungthai-AXA's policies?
Within Krungthai-AXA, we've tried to become a very diverse, inclusive, open organisation. So we've implemented same-sex employee benefits for our LGBT staff. Mm-hmm. So if they can prove that they are in a committed relationship for 2 years, then we will extend the same rights as a spouse would have under our company benefits. We've also gone to the extent of giving leave entitlements for people who want gender reorganisation. So based on medical advice in terms of timing, etc., then we will give paid leave for people to go through the procedure. We also have a free dress policy. So if a man wants to come to work at a dress, no problem with that as well. And we do find at company activities, etc., we do have a lot of men turning up in alternative clothing.
And now I'm curious, a similar sort of thing that I talked about our previous two panels with, was there a sort of conservative, if not pushback, then was there a messaging issue that you had to put out in advance of this to more conservative, more traditional employees?
Of course, because we're all human, there's a lot of unconscious bias out there, and we need to be able to try and overcome that unconscious bias. But for me, you know, I don't want the D&I policy to be a bolt-on of HR.
Yes.
Because a lot of people see that if it's just a bolt-on, it's something on the side. Mm-hmm. It's a tick in a box to make sure that you followed some corporate guidelines somewhere in the world. For me, it needs to be led from the top. There needs to be a tone from the top so that staff can see that this is the right thing to do. Mm-hmm. I know people talk about business cases, etc. I don't see this as a business case. Mm-hmm. To me, it's not done for financial reasons. It's done because it is the right thing to do, to make sure that other people who are minorities or they are excluded in society, whether they are LGBT, whether they're people with disability, gender, age, etc., are included within the organisation.
I wonder, I'd like to pick up on that point you made about not being a bolt-on. Mm. How do you avoid that? You want a D&I policy that's really bone deep within an organisation. How do you do that?
You need to build it into the DNA of your organisation. That's why it comes from me as the CEO. Okay, so that's why if there are forums like this, etc., it's me as CEO out there talking about it so people can see this is not something which just comes from your HR. Mm-hmm. For instance, last year, our company was luckily awarded by the UN in New York an award for working with people with disability in Thailand. We were also nominated by the Journal in Diversity out of the US as one of the top 25 thought leaders at the moment in the world on the topic of diversity. We sponsored this year with AirAsia as our co-sponsor, Miss International Queen, which is the International Transgender Beauty Contest, which was held in Thailand. And I was very lucky to meet Kevin as well at that event. So it's getting out there, doing things. In December, for the first time in 11 years, we will have a gay pride parade in Thailand. So we'll be sponsoring it. I'm a straight male, but I'll be out front leading that parade. So it's really showing that there is no difference.
Yes.
Great. There is. I'd like to pick up on something else you mentioned, which is unconscious bias, which is a thorny problem. It's one thing to have a policy that outlaws sort of over-discrimination, but how do you tackle the unconscious bias in your employees?
Well, there's many ways to do it. I think reverse mentoring is one very good way to do it, to make people feel comfortable around LGBT community. There's a lot that they can teach us. I personally grew up in a very conservative society in New Zealand. I had a lot of unconscious bias before I came to Asia as well, and I had a lot of very good teams and friends that opened my eyes. So I think that reverse mentoring helps a lot. The other way you can do it is to have a confidential hotline where people who are feeling discriminated against within the organisation feel comfortable calling up and discussing with a counsellor, etc. So they feel like it's not going to come back to their manager and come back to them eventually. So there's many processes you can put in place.
Okay. Thank you. I'd like to turn to Mr. Hirano, to Pina now. Yeah. Set the stage for us. LGBT rights in Japan, cultural attitudes. What's the ocean in which you swim?
Okay. First, I'd like to start with a number. That is 7.6%. What do you think that is the number? 7.6. That is a number of percentage of LGBT in Japan by recent the research in Japan. So 7.6 is very large number, which means one person in 13 people. That means two people in a school class, which is huge. On the other hand, but the as you may know, in Japan, the LGBT is now it's much known, but not so much accepted in the society. For instance, our constitutional law doesn't allow the same-sex marriage yet. And so, but the because the society gradually accepting the LGBT, so some small local government now publish the partnership certification of the same-sex marriage. So it is still about 10 local government out of 1,700 local government, but it's moving slow, but it's moving. So that is a situation of Japan.
Why so slow? I mean, what's the slow? Bias?
Yeah, the constitutional law is a basic law. That is a big stuff. And in Japan, the changing a constitutional law is a kind of taboo. It is not changed over 70 years after World War II. And then the most major party, the political party, ADP, is very conservative about the changing whole of the constitutional law, including LGBT or such kind of sexual diversity stuff. So that is the basic stuff. And also because in the society, the people are grown in that kind of environment. So the normal sexuality is a normal. So the people feel the others, like LGBT, is abnormal. So that the feeling is bad. So not, that is the circumstances.
And within that context, what are Infoteria's policies?
Yeah, so actually, when I started my company, before I started my company, I worked for the US-based company for 10 years. So I'm very used to deal with the diversity. And then I started a very diversity-aware company. And now, 2 years ago, I aware more about LGBT action needed. So I started the initiative in my company to accept the LGBT and change the rule, company rule, like the accept the same-sex marriage. That means for the sick leave for the partners and cash gift for the marriage or the partners. So and then I took made some program to learn study about LGBT, inviting real LGBT people like Koyuki or Hiroko, who is a major in Japan. And then also I express our action to the public to influence our activity to the Japan society.
And what was the reaction like, both from the public, from your peers, and from your employees?
yes. Well, for the beginning, the employees understand what I'm saying because they know it, but they really cannot understand what to do. So I made some programs to learn about LGBT, hear from LGBT people. Mm-hmm. So that increases the acceptance. Also, in the public, we actually did the press release about our action. And some of the people said it's very good stuff. But some of the people say that's a kind of PR. Mm. It's a stunt play. So, but I'm really prepared to hearing that because if it is small, someone need to start. So we are a very small public company, but when we start, it will change to the other company. That's our aim.
And you do change from the top down. I know when we spoke earlier, you mentioned the four A's that a CEO needs to follow. I thought that was really useful. I wonder if you could explain it to the audience.
what I mentioned is a four A's. Four A. So there's a four process to accept the LGBT. First A is awareness. The people, employee and the people need to aware what the LGBT issue is. Mm-hmm. And then the accept is that they need to accept the LGBT in their selves and their organization. Mm-hmm. And then third A is action to change the rule or make a program like I did. And the fourth one, it is also important, is appeal. So many companies only do the three A's, but the appeal is also important in Japan because many, many companies don't do actions for the LGBT. So appealing the program and the how we change the rule is very important for the reference and influence to other companies.
So what about the role of the IT sector more broadly? Do you think they have a special responsibility, a special opportunity?
Yes. We are, as he introduced, the software development company. And I always think about how IT can help the acceptance of LGBT in the society. And the IT is helpful for LGBT. For instance, the easy one is a social network. Mm-hmm. Yeah, using social network, LGBT people can connect and communicate and collaborate themselves over the organization or over the border. So it is, I think the social network helps such kind of issue. In addition, I'm dreaming about the new technologies like AI, artificial intelligence. So using artificial intelligence aided hiring. Mm-hmm. So that might get rid of some prejudice, human prejudice of the hiring process. So because AI is programmed to be right for the rules, so AI could help. On the other hand, the blockchain, do you hear about blockchain technology?
Yes.
Using blockchain, that may get rid of the fake document that blames the LGBT people. So based on the traceability features of blockchain. So we are the IT company or software company, I'm always thinking about those kinds of stuff, how to help.
Okay, I'd like to open the floor for questions, but first, can we put, let's go back to the polling question. Can we put those results up? Do company bosses do enough to champion LGBT rights in public? In the room, wow, sorry guys. 92% said no. 8% said yes. Let's look at the social media question.
Present company excluded.
Company excluded.
I hope so.
Social media, I guess it looks marginally better. 72% said no, 28% said yes. And 3,000 people answered that. So there's work to do. There's work to do. Questions from the audience. Raise your hand and I'll get a mic to you. Yes, right there. And please tell us, do you have your hand up? Tell us who you are. And what company you represent.
Hi, my name is Michael Lam. I'm from Goldman Sachs, and I have a question for Michael. We are all colleagues and friends to someone, more than someone, and some of us are even managers to other people. And unfortunately, sometimes we do say things that we don't know about that would have long-term impact to people. So my question to you, actually two parts of the question is, after your slightly unpleasant experience with your prior employer when they confronted you with your sexual orientation, how did that impact you personally in terms of your coming out journey forward? And also the second question is, how did that impact your working experience with your prior employer after that?
Initially, you withdraw because you think, I don't want to ruin my career. And so you withdraw, you sit in meetings and you don't want to draw any attention to yourself. You just want to sit in the corner, nobody look at me, nothing going on here. And so you don't participate in meetings, you're not putting your ideas forward. That's what I initially felt. Sadly for me, I left the organization. And as I say, I really want to say that IBM is the absolute global leader at the moment. And it's changed a lot. But I left the organization. When I joined the new organization, my next employer, I decided to be out from day one. And that, to me, was a massive relief because there was no secret anymore. Mm-hmm. I didn't need to go through all of that again. Mm-hmm. And I just found that my career changed because I could literally, people talk about bringing your whole self to work. Mm-hmm. I think I bought 120% of myself to work. I was just liberated, freed. I didn't care what people thought because there was no whispering going on. And it was just easier. And but obviously not everybody can go through. Everyone's journey is different. Everyone's journey is very, very different. And people have got to deal with that in their own time. But to have the right environment is the most important thing. And I think, you know, the role of a CEO, our job as CEOs is to create the right environment so that people can do their best work. And you're not going to do your best work if you don't feel accepted and involved in the organisation. Hopefully that's kind of answered both parts.
Thank you. Thank you. Another question.
That's one down there.
Let's see. Yes, sorry, right there in the front.
Hi, panel. Jagas from HSBC. We're very fortunate that we've got some strong allies and leaders on the panel today. What I want to ask is, to what extent do you think it appropriate, and how can you use your influence with your counterparts in other organisations that perhaps aren't at the same level as yourselves?
Do you want me to...
For
me, I think it's about... If you've got a CEO who isn't as accepting, may not have come on the journey, so to speak, for me, it's about storytelling. I find stories are the most powerful way to get somebody to understand the journey or the plight of somebody else. I would say that as a broadcaster, that's what we do, we tell stories. But I've found in my experience, when I've spoken to other CEOs about the importance of having the right environment, just getting them to talk to people, and you know, you touched on the reverse mentoring thing, having people who have struggled with this journey and not being able to be themselves at work, sharing those sort of stories with a CEO. Most CEOs I know have just gone, I kind of get it now. And that's really powerful to be exposed, because often it's not that they're bigots or anything like that, it's just that they haven't had an opportunity to be exposed to how difficult it is for a GLBT employee. And so setting up those environments for your executives, if you've got some executives that you know think, oh, this is all just, you know, warm, fluffy stuff that HR should take care of and I don't need to be involved, you know, finding environments where you can get those sort of stories to them. And I think CEOs do react to that.
Okay, I see red light in front of us, which means I've got to wrap up. I think if I take one thing away from this session, it's the importance of openness in how people live and in how you communicate within your company.
Visibility.
Openness and visibility, those are really key. It's now time for our first break. We're going to break for, I think, half an hour. Please thank our panel, and please join me back here at 11:40.
Thank you.